Penguin Random House Audio presents Dancers on the Shore, stories by William Melvin Kelley, read for you by Jay Smooth. When I read a dedication in another book, I always wonder who the person is and what he or she has done for the writer to make him offer his book as humble repayment. There is a chance, I think, you too have wondered about such things. So before I dedicate this book to her, I would like to introduce you to my grandmother. She came to New York 70 years ago, and having a great talent for sewing, was soon working steadily as a dressmaker. These two facts will help you to understand something that happened about 4 years ago. At that time, I had just decided I would try to write. Since most everyone I knew had expected me to choose a more secure and respectable occupation, and since the desire to write was really a vague undergraduate yearning, I felt called upon to give some explanation to someone. I also felt that if my grandmother, who was the only family I had, understood, I could stand up to the others when they asked me why I did not have a decent job. As I sat talking to her, I began to feel sure the 60 years separating us would be too much, that I would not be able to explain to her the feeling writing gave me. For a half hour, she sat sewing and listening. For a half hour, I gave reasons, explanations, and examples, and finally, when I slumped back, exhausted and discouraged, it seemed to me I had made no sense at all. For a moment, she looked at me, making certain I had finished. Then she smiled. "I know. I couldn't have made dresses for 70 years unless I loved it." To my grandmother, Jessie Garcia, with admiration, gratitude, and love. No, they were not inhuman. Well, you know, that was the worst of it. This suspicion of their not being inhuman. It would come slowly to one. They howled and leaped and spun and made horrid faces. But what thrilled you was just the thought of their humanity, like yours. The thought of your remote kinship with this wild and passionate uproar. Ugly. Yes, it was ugly enough. But if you were man enough, you would admit to yourself that there was in you just the faintest trace of a response to the terrible frankness of that noise. A dim suspicion of there being a meaning in it which you, so remote from the night of first ages, could comprehend. And why not? The mind of man is capable of anything, because everything is in it, all the past as well as all the future. What was there, after all? Joy, fear, sorrow, devotion, valor, rage? Who can tell? But truth stripped of its cloak of time. Let the fool gape and shudder. The man knows and can look on without a wink. But he must at least be as much of a man as these on the shore. Joseph Conrad, Heart of Darkness. Preface. An American writer who happens to have brown skin faces this unique problem. Solutions and answers to the Negro problem are very often read into his work. At the instant they open his book, his readers begin to search fervently, and often with honest concern, for some key or answer to what is happening today between the black and white people in America. At this time, let me say for the record that I am not a sociologist or a politician or a spokesman. Such people try to give answers. A writer, I think, should ask questions. He should depict people, not symbols or ideas disguised as people. I am an American Negro. I hope I am a writer, but perhaps the latter statement is not mine to judge. William Melvin Kelley. The Only Man on Liberty Street. She was squatting in the front yard, digging with an old brass spoon in the dirt which was an ocean to the islands of short yellow grass. She wore a red and white checkered dress, which hung loosely from her shoulders and obscured her legs. It was early spring, and she was barefoot. Her toes stuck from under the skirt. She could not see the man yet, riding down Liberty Street. His shoulders square, the duster he wore spread back over the horse's rump, a carpet bag tied with a leather strap to the saddle horn and knocking against his leg. She could not see him until he had dismounted and tied his horse to a small, black, iron Negro jockey and unstrapped the bag. She watched now as he opened the wooden gate, came into the yard, and stood, looking down at her, his face stern, almost gray beneath the brim of his wide hat. She knew him. Her mother called him Mr. Herder and had told Jenny that he was Jenny's father. He was one of the men who came riding down Liberty Street in their fine black suits and starched shirts and large dark ties. Each of these men had a house to go to, into which, in the evening usually, he would disappear. Only women and children lived on Liberty Street. All of them were Negroes. Some of the women were quite dark, but most were coffee color. They were all very beautiful. Her mother was light. She was tall, had black eyes, and black hair so long she could sit on it. The man standing over her was the one who came to her house once or twice a week. He was never there in the morning when Jenny got up. He was tall and thin and blonde. He had a short beard that looked as coarse as the grass beneath her feet. His eyes were blue, like Jenny's. He did not speak English very well. Jenny's mother had told her he came from across the sea, and Jenny often wondered if he went there between visits to their house. "Jenny, your mother tells me that you ask why I do not stay at night. Is so?" She looked up at him. "Yes, Mr. Herder." The hair under his jaw was darker than the hair on his cheeks. He nodded. "I stay now. Go bring your mother." She left the spoon in the dirt and ran into the house, down the long hall, dark now because she had been sitting in the sun. She found her mother standing over the stove, a great black lid in her left hand, a wooden spoon in her right. There were beads of sweat on her forehead. She wore a full black skirt and a white blouse. Her one waist-length braid hung straight between her shoulder blades. She turned to Jenny's running steps.
"Mama, that man, my father, he in the yard, he brung a carpet bag."
First her mother smiled, then frowned, then looked puzzled.
"A carpet bag, darling?"
"Yes, Mama."
She followed her mother through the house, pausing with her at the hall mirror where the woman ran her hand up the back of her neck to smooth stray black hair. Then they went on to the porch, where the man was now seated, surveying the tiny yard and the dark green hedge that enclosed it. The carpet bag rested beside his chair. Her mother stood with her hands beneath her apron, staring at the bag.
"Mr. Herder?"
He turned to them.
"I will not go back this time.
No matter what.
Why should I live in that house when I must come here to know what home is?"
He nodded sharply, as if in answer to a question.
"So, I stay. I give her that house. I will send her money, but I stay here."
Her mother stood silently for an instant, then turned to the door.
"Dinner will be on the table in a half hour."
She opened the screen door. The spring whined and cracked.
"Oh."
She let go the door and picked up the carpet bag.
"I'll take this on up."
She went inside. As she passed, Jenny could see she was smiling again. After that, Jenny's mother became a celebrity on Liberty Street. The other women would stop her to ask about the man.
"And he's staying for good, Josie?"
"Yes."
"You have any trouble yet?"
"Not yet."
"Well, child, you make him put that there house in your name. You don't want to be no Sissy Markham. That white woman come down the same day he died and moved Sissy and her children right into the gutter. You get that house put in your name, you hear?"
"Yes."
"How is it? It different?"
Her mother would look dazed.
"Yes, it different. He told me to call him Maynard."
The other women were always very surprised. At first, Jenny, too, was surprised.
The man was always there in the morning, and sometimes even woke her up. Her mother no longer called him Mr. Herder, and at odd times, though still quite seldom, said, "No." She had never before heard her mother say no to anything.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.